Jai Gurudev. It is said that art connects the world, but there are some people who manage to connect the entire world while being an artist. Today we have with us one such person, Srividya Barchaswi, who over the last decade has become the face of dance for Art of Living. With all the wonderful projects in which she has connected people, Srividya, I want to take you back to 2016 to the Cosmic Rhythm at the World Culture Festival, where there were thousands of people who came together in the finale with you. And for the first time, I think the world saw how some thousands of people can be coordinated online without ever meeting, but come together as one in the end and dance a choreography. How did you manage that? What was it that made you feel confident that, yes, this is something I can do?
Jai Gurudev. So, firstly, a very, very warm welcome to everybody and thank you for joining us for this interaction. Coming back to Sunil about World Culture Festival, if you ask me, I think Gurudev has always been a pioneer in setting a trend. Today, when we look at the scenario that the world is in, online choreography, online dancing, online coordination seems like the new norm. But like you and me both know, 4 years ago, it was not the case. And I think Gurudev had already set the trend at that time. For me, coordinating across different countries, we had about 48 countries participating, as you know. And we had thousands of artists. It was very, very effortless because I think all the teams were led by people who meditate. And that, I think, is the USP of the Art of Living, that everybody here meditates, you know. And so they have the ability to take on a lot more than what is obviously manageable. You know, as an artist, we set boundaries for ourselves, not just as artists, as human beings, as leadership people in leadership positions also, you set a boundary for yourself which somehow limits you. When you meditate, you are open to the possibility of, yes, why not? You know, and that is Sattvic Dhriti. We talk about it in dance as well. We show it many times in a lot of rasas as well, in a lot of stories. And this is what truly helped us during Cosmic Rhythm. Everybody was aligned to a vision, right? So one thing that we have had long discussions about is when we bring artists together, it is somewhat of a challenge that people feel because they feel two artists can never stand on one stage together. In fact, a very well-known dancer had also commented that I will be surprised if you can get 500 dancers to come on one stage together. I feel if the vision is clear and the intention is sincere, then art goes back to what it was supposed to be. Art is an expression of joy, of everything that is refined about us as human beings. And as meditators, I feel this is effortless for us. So if you ask me what really helped me personally through that was a great team. And like they say, Sange Shakti Kali Yuge, no? In this yuga, what really, really works is the power of a team. And I have been very lucky to be blessed by a great team, always very supportive. And of course, I look up to Gurudev each time. And when I look at him working tirelessly every single day, reaching out to so many communities, I don't find bringing two artists together to be a Herculean task. I think it's very, very simple.
You have made it simple, Srividya, and you mentioned vision as well as sincerity. But not as a meditator, now I ask you as a choreographer. Most choreographers face a challenge that if we can't, don't even know who are the dancers who are going to appear in front of us, they many a times get frazzled about quality control, about maintaining their vision through. But recently, you had Meera the Musical, which staged in 4 different cities in the last year. And in each city, you had a whole new team where you met the team a day before the show, sometimes rarely 2 days before the show. And still, you were very confident that the whole show is going to come together. That is something which no other choreographer in India would take up that confidently that irrespective of me even meeting the team, my vision as a choreographer is going to come through. So I want to know, as a meditator, do you get those glimpses that this is how the product is going to look like, even though I haven't seen it right now? Does that happen to you?
So I think, you know, Sunil, it's a good deal of discipline and freedom together. Like, as a good leader, I feel, of course, as a meditator, it helps. But as a leader, this is something from a leadership perspective that I would like to share to everybody who is a director or wants to choreograph. Because as a choreographer, you are directing the show. I feel you must have faith in your team, one. Secondly, you have to learn to delegate well. So there are certain people who are good at choreography. There are certain people who are good at taking practice. There are certain people who are good at rehearsing. There are certain people good at making costumes. There are other people who may be good at coordination logistics. You have to know whom to give what. So that's again, it comes back to the same thing, that comes through intuition. And like I said, for me, it has never been a struggle to bring people together or to organize events from a different location, because I had a great team. You were a very integral part of my team. And you would see that in while coordinating, you need to give the person who is on the field that amount of freedom. You have to stop being like they say, a control freak. No, we have to let go of it sometimes, because I feel art is not something that is linear. It has amazing possibilities. So I may have thought of a choreography in a certain way and I communicate my idea to the person who's on the ground. But if they thought of it in a slightly different way, which makes it more beautiful, why not? I think humility and the willingness to grow is truly what makes a good choreographer and a director. Like many times I have seen, you know, whenever I've even trained people, sometimes they tell me, you know, okay, why don't we do it like this? And then I look at it and I said, yeah, why not? Why don't we do it like this? We don't have to do it in the way I thought. And sometimes you will be astounded by just the energy which changes by subtle changes in the choreography. And why not? The whole sense, I feel, is of doership, which you have to kind of over time let go, you know, and it happens. It does happen. It eventually happens. It either happens with age or it happens through wisdom and spiritual practices, where you realize that you are just an instrument. You truly are just an instrument. Things are happening through you. And it's very beautiful. I feel as artists, we are truly blessed because we have the ability to express in a way that a majority of the population cannot. And we must not let go of the true essence of dance, singing, music. I mean, it is...
That's really beautiful, especially what you have given us, the link of freedom within the framework. And the tiffany for all the people out there want to choreograph and direct is that you are not the director or the choreographer. Don't be the doer. So once we can let go of that, I think the stress or the screaming and shouting that accompanies most directors and doesn't seem to be a part of Sri Vidya's ethos, we can become a part of that.
But Sunil, I must add, I need all the screamers and shouters on the ground. I may not do it myself, but without them, without, you know, that essential need to push, things don't come out the way they do. I mean, it's obvious. There is no substitute for hard work. There is no substitute for rehearsals. There is no substitute for sincerity. And I truly look up to everybody. Everybody's style of leading is different, you know, and everybody's approach to dance in general is very different. Everybody looks at a certain piece very differently. And I think everybody is important in the master plan. You know, everybody has a place. They need to be there. And I truly value everybody who's worked with me. Some of them are very tough taskmasters. And they need to be the way they are. Everybody cannot be the same. But yes, you should do it on the field, like on the practice floor. But when you leave the practice, you should be free. You shouldn't not be able to sleep at night because, oh my God, the rehearsals are not done.
That's another really good tip you've given everyone, because I know people stay up at night when things are not going as per their direction. And coming to your own personal journey as a dancer, I request you to share a memory that you have of your favorite performance when I know you're a meditator, so you always experience the sattva and the rasa. But in your early days, did you have those experiences in dance as you were as a child, as a young dancer, when you were training under your teachers and performing? What was it that made you feel like this is something you want to be? Because right now, when we think of Sri Vidya, we think of a meditator, an art of living teacher, but also dancer. That's very much a part of the way people perceive you. So did you know that's how it's going to be?
Not really. While growing up, I was very lucky to have a very, very holistic upbringing. So while my parents encouraged me to dance, they also encouraged me to play football. I also did karate. I grew up with three boys at home. So, you know, with three brothers, you're nothing short of a tomboy. I think dance saved me. But in terms of having experiences while dancing, definitely. While growing up, I felt a very strong connection to Nataraja, you know, while growing up. It was very, very evident to me. And, you know, so in my dance class, there is still that statue of Nataraja, which is right in the center of the dance class. And I remember I used to only look at the statue and dance. And I remember one time my teacher's teacher had come to visit us, and he had commented that she doesn't look anywhere else. Her focus is only on Nataraja. He doesn't look who's looking at her, what they're liking, they're not liking. And I was very small at that time. I think I was in fourth grade maybe. And I felt a very, very strong connection there. And I have to tell you a very funny incident. So when I was like, I think I just done my Arangetram. I was about 11 or 12 years old. 11, I think. And, you know, we had these some competitions, like zonal competitions or something like that. And my teacher was very clear. Until you do your Arangetram, you're not stepping on the stage. And I was also very happy dancing in that room. You know, I was never interested in. So this dance competition happened, and then they registered. And then my teacher said, yeah, if you want to go, you go. And so my parents came, my class people came, and, you know, I went for the competition. It was in one of those, I forgot the name of the hall. And I danced. And even as a young dancer, you are quite understanding of your talent. No, you know where you stand somewhere. There's a basic intelligence that every artist has. So I saw everybody's performance, and like, I was pretty sure I'm going to win. You know, like, I saw all of them, and I was like, I mean, I've got this. Like, so they started, after some time, they started announcing the winners, and, you know, third prize goes to this person. Second prize goes to this. There's a tie in the second prize, one person and one person. So I said, oh, I'm so good. I'm going to get first prize. Wow, in my head, I was thinking. And then suddenly they announced the prize, and it was not me, you know. And I was so confused, because I started doubting every inch of my existence at that point, because I was so young. But, you know, something just hits you. Like, so anyway, I was so disheartened. I didn't even bother having a conversation, nothing. So my seniors from school were also with me, and of course they would have also seen the whole competition, and they found something not okay. So they went to the judges, and, you know, they went to the organizers, sorry, not the judges. And they asked, what is this? What are the basis for which, you know, you have done? Because we've seen all the performances and we feel that it's not appropriate or whatever. You know how emotional people can get. So then the organizer said that, no, she was disqualified. So they were really surprised. Why was she disqualified? She was very good, but she was disqualified. So they said, why? I said, no, because she was underage. So they were really upset, because they said there is no younger age for a competition. There can be an upper age. There's nothing mentioned in the rule book. No. And then later on, we came to know that the judge's niece was a part of the competition and she had won the first prize. Now, as a child, when you're so young and you hear this so-called, in my words, corruption, I was really, really, really upset. And I remember going back and I was in my dance class and this, my friends told me later that apparently I had a conversation with Nataraja there. And I said, from today, I will never dance in front of people. I will only dance for you and I will never dance. I will only dance for Shiva. I will not dance anywhere else, you know. And rightly so, the next time I performed was in Yuvratri. I never danced in between anywhere. And I was very, very shy in terms of expressing my talent outside in classical dancing. Other stuff I used to participate, but I said that is too sacred for me to, you know, take out anywhere. Because as a child, I was so impacted by what had happened. It was such a strong impression. And then one day after, I remember the reason why I agreed to go for Yuvratri was Gurudev was in a satsang one day and then he said, your talents are for others. And for me, this was a shocker of my life because for me, I was like, I don't want people to see me dancing. They don't understand and I'm not doing it for them. I don't need appreciation. You know, I don't need validation. I don't want to be criticized or praised. Both I don't want. So then Gurudev said, your talents are for others. And I just looked like, I don't understand this. Why are my talents for others? They said, no. Why do you cook? When do you cook? When somebody is there to eat the food and appreciate it. That's when you feel like cooking. Otherwise, you will eat something simple in the house. Then I said, oh, yeah, that makes sense. And he said, who likes to sing? So he said, because when people hear you singing, then that is where your talent is valued. Then he said, you know, when do you like to dance? So I was giving like a blank look like at him, you know. I still remember, I was sitting somewhere in among the thousands, but I felt he was talking to me. He said, you like to dance? When is your dance truly worthy? He didn't even say, when do you like? He said, when is your dance truly worthy of its talent? When you share it, when people see it. And that's when it hit me like a lightning bolt, you know. And since then, I have not shied away from, you know, performing. But I have had these experiences where, you know, my whole understanding of art, my whole basis of performance did change. After that day, it changed for me. Everything changed. You know, it was like somebody just brought me out of that little bubble that I was living in and said, come on, you know, you're, whatever you have is for others. It's, what are you going to do keeping it with you? So, you know, you have to share it. And that's when I said, okay, let's do this, you know.
That's such a beautiful sharing. And I didn't know this story of your childhood before. But
haven't shared it with anybody yet. First time.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing it here. And what you mentioned about you always dancing for the Nataraja. That's what the Natya Shastra talks about, of the dance of Shiva and the Karana being Atma Bhimuki, that the dancer should dance only for themselves. And but in today's day and world, it's very difficult because the moment you start learning dance, you're trained to start performing for others. And I used to always wonder what this is. And now that you've shared this beautiful journey, I think that's, here we see a beautiful tip. There are some other maestros who also shared this before, that they never like to perform for others, up till a certain point in age when someone came and gave them a push that you have to go because others have to enjoy your talent. And that happened with Pandit Biju Maharaj ji and many others who have been through this similar journey. So it's, I think that's very beautiful what you shared, and we have Nataraja right here today. And I remember the first time all of us saw you, at least I saw you as Parvati on stage. So that was, I think, one of the first beautiful big projects in 2013. Or 14, when you brought different dance styles together and
I had a very good Shiva also.
Thank you. So I now ask you about your rasa experience, and from the point of view of dancers, you know, in the meditation and meditative practices are very important for dancers. it is in the dance community that it is the most lacking many times, because dancers take for granted that, oh, our dance itself is meditative, so we don't need something else. And where this happens is when you're at the peak of rasa on stage, and then you move off stage, and within a few seconds, they get hit by the real world. It's happened to me, it's happened to many of the people whom I've observed. Suddenly, you're in that peak of bhakti because the dance form is taking you into it. But in that 1 second, it all shatters, and then you don't know how to handle it. And you played one of the most iconic characters ever in India, that is Meerabai. And we have had stories of how M.S. Subbulakshmi ji has painted on sets, and each dancer from Hema Malini to any other dancer who has played Meerabai has always had some such experience. So what was your experience each time when you merged with the Dwarkadish and in that peak of emotion? What do you feel then, or is there something that you felt that you can share with us?
Yes, absolutely. For me, Meerabai has always been somebody who is inspiring. She is a complete woman, despite whatever, society said. And her journey is just so real and so relatable for me personally also. And whenever I was on stage, it didn't need, as devotees, I think it's easiest for us, because for us, we see Krishna everywhere, as you can see behind me also. So Meerabai was and is always one of my favorite characters to play, because Meerabai is human, and her journey is so real. And I was like in a different world only. Every time I was on stage playing Meerabai, it was not just a beautiful production, but it was an honor to play that role, And everybody knows my rehearsal discipline, which is zero. So I really didn't get much time to rehearse myself, because, you're so focused on everybody else. But for me, it was the easiest role to play, because I didn't have to do much. For me, it is very, very real. Her passion, her love, her devotion is so relatable for me, because I experience that. I feel that completely. And it is just astounding to, and I think somewhere it was the time for Meerabai's work to be, heard and listened and spoke about again, because I remember whichever show we did, whether it was Bangalore, whether it was Bombay, Delhi, Pune, they were in tears throughout. And genuinely speaking, there was no melodrama, or, sometimes in some scenes you need to give a huge push to the scene, like to make it a tearjerker. But here, from the time the music started in the beginning, Ghanshyam, Ayore, Little Meera enters on stage, people were in tears. So it was something about the energy of that time. Like Gurudev says, there's a very important contribution of time. And I think that time was such where her work needed to reach people, and it did. And for me personally, there is no other role that I have played where I have felt so complete. I've played gods and goddesses, and of course that's very beautiful, that is ethereal, but there is no room for the imperfections of the human mind, And to be in a limited body and to experience that expanse of divinity is what Meerabai was. And that is something is truly beautiful, because Gurudev has helped us experience that through, satsang, seva, sadhana. And for me, it was very
stage, did you cease to be Srividya and become Meera? Did you feel a gradual?
I think so, because I was blanked out. I blanked out multiple times, I remember. And in fact, during the photo shoot itself, it had started. When we did the photo shoot in, about a month before the show, on a couple of weeks before the show, I remember I was spinning and rightfully so, I just fainted. And you remember when we were doing the shoot for one production, I kept turning and I kept falling down for so, I had no idea why, because I usually am not so, you know, I kept fainting again and again. And I think it's just, it was just the energy. It was beautiful. I didn't get hurt. So that's good.
I think all of us who were part of Mirabai with you and watched it, I know people may say we are biased, but I would like to share that, like you said, since childhood, I was absolutely fascinated by Mirabai, to the extent that my friends would call me Meera Boy, that you're so fascinated by her and her songs and you keep singing them and that. And with you in this production, the greatest memory I have is of the finale, when all of us together are on stage. And at that point of time, even though I know you since so many years and have danced with you as Shiva and have been a part of so many other productions, I could not see you as Srividya anymore at that moment, because I was like, this is a true experience of when the character is transformed into a different energy. And we could feel that in you absolutely, as a viewer, as being a part of the stage. And that's what got me to wondering, what is it that, that, and as you mentioned now, that being a human, having those imperfections, but being able to connect with the divine, I think that, which becomes difficult for everyone playing gods and goddesses, then there's a pressure on people to be perfect, which we know somewhere inside that we are not. But as Meera, through that bhakti, you could take us on that journey. That was truly, truly beautiful. And having experienced it, I can really share that with others, my own experience of watching you undergo that transformation. And I think this is a good point to bring it to an end about art connecting the world. What next, Srividya? What is your next big project? This is my question to you as we close.
I have not actually thought of anything. As you know, Sunil, I'm super sporadic and I don't have anything planned. But whenever something does come up, everybody will know. As you know, I love working with teams. For me, I need a team. I need to have like a lot of people, you know, out there. And that is why I insist in any production, I make sure no matter where the story has taken itself, I make sure that every single person from the team is on stage in the end, because for me, that is what works. That's my feeling. But yes, maybe next, let's see, we have a very beautiful Ram Mandir coming. So let's see, maybe something in line with that. Let's see.
Wonderful. So we have a bit of an inkling that the direction in which it can go. Thanks for that that spoiler or the hint that you've given our viewers, so we can look.
Actually, it's not a spoiler. It's good. I'm putting seeds in everybody's head now. It's good.
Your team will soon start contacting you when I'm chatting this. So thank you so much, Srividya, for this wonderful interaction and being a part of our Art of Living Academy of Performing Arts Sadhana Saptah. Thank you. Jai Gurudev.
Thank you, Sunil. Jai Gurudev.
Ganga Jamuna su kaam nahi re.
Time stands still.
Krishna would run from the house of the gopis
till it's time for your wedding.
Who will be my groom, ma?
You will be proud of your son today.
Give me this strength.
You have not even entered the house.
No shyness. No shame.
I will be wherever my lord is.
Subhanallah! Out of my sight!
That you will never forget.
There is not else.
A mere woman is no match for the Rana of Chittor.
Revolution of devotion was on the rise.
Dark rain clouds?
It is not easy for a woman
to sacrifice the protection of our home.
Ego is a barrier, a wall of separation from the real self. Where is there place for anger or hatred?